Dear friend, welcome to the lecture series in Signals and Systems. Today's topic is analogy between vectors and signals. Here we have a new term, analogy. Analogy refers to understanding a new problem by comparing it with the known phenomena. Now let us talk about the importance of the analogy and how the analogy is really helpful in understanding the problems. Here let us consider the water tank analogy. Let us have a water tank filled with the water, connected with a water pipe, and we are going to collect the water using a tub or some other item. Now, when the pressure is created on the surface of the water tank onto the water, then the water will flow through the water pipe and it will be collected by the tub. Here, the rate of water flow through the pipe will be controlled by the width of the pipe. Here, we consider that the pressure as voltage, the water as charge, the water flow as flow of charge or current, and the width of the pipe as resistance. So here we understood the voltage, current, and resistance by the known phenomena of water tank. This way, a new thing can be easily understood by studying the already existed phenomena. We also try to look at one more analogy, water pipe analogy. Here, to the horizontal earth surface, let us hold a water pipe and it is having the ends A and B. Both the ends are at the same height. Now the water will not flow from the point A to point B. We can say it is still water. Here we consider that water pipe as conductor and the height as potential. So at height, at the point A, we call that one as potential A. At the point B, we call the potential B. So here there is no charge flow from point A to point B within the conductor. As we know that when the element both ends or conductor ends are hold at the same potential, then there is no possibility of current flow inside the conductor or element. Also, we look at one more criteria here. To the horizontal earth surface, now the water pipe is tilted. Here the end A is at the higher level and end B is at the lower level. Now the water will flow from point A to point B. We can say the water pipe as a conductor, water as the charge, and the point A is at hold at the higher potential and point B is at the lower potential. Now we see that the charge will flow from the higher potential to lower potential, and also we can conclude that the charge cannot flow, that is current will not flow from the lower potential to higher potential. So this way we can understand the flow of current with respect to the potentials within a conductor or electrical elements. So this way the analogy is very helpful in order to understand the new things by applying onto the known phenomena. Now, if we understand the vectors, then we can easily apply the things to the signals. Here we will be considering two vectors. Let us consider those vectors as vector V1 and vector V2. Now what we are going to do is we try to find out the component of V1 vector along the V2 vector. So for that, let us consider three cases. So in case one, we have a vector V1 and we have another vector V2. Now, in order to find out the component of a vector V1 onto the vector V2 can be done in infinity ways, and that can be done by using the geometrical way by drawing the lines from tip of the V1 to the vector V2. Now, what we do is we take the tip of the vector V1 and we try to draw a line geometrically onto the vector V2. So here, this particular portion becomes the similarity. Then we are writing that one, the similarity component as C1 and along with vector V2. So we are writing that one as C1 V2, and this particular portion becomes the error vector 1. Now we take one more case, case 2. In case 2, we have the vector V1 bar and we have the vector V2 bar. Now from the tip of vector V1, we are drawing a line geometrically onto the vector v2. Now this particular portion becomes the similarity or component of v1 along v2. So we are writing this one as c2 v2, and this particular portion as the error. So here we are writing that error vector as ve2 bar. And finally, we take another case, case 3. Here we have the vector v1 bar and one more vector v2 bar. Now geometrically we are drawing a normal line from the tip of the vector v1 onto the vector v2. So here again this portion we can write as the similarity or component of v1 along the v2. So we are writing this one as c12 v2. Then this particular portion becomes the error vector ve bar. Now we can write certain expressions which are related to the case 1, case 2, and case 3. Here we can write the vector v1 as c1 v2 plus ve1 bar. And here this v2 is also a vector. And coming to case 2, so we can write v1 as c2 v2 bar plus ve2 bar. And coming to case 3, v1 equal to c12 v2 bar plus ve bar. In all the three cases, we can also write the error vector expression. So ve1 equal to v1 bar minus c1 v2 bar. And in case 2, ve2 bar equal to v1 bar minus c2 v2 bar. And in case of 3, ve bar equal to v1 bar minus c1 to v2 bar. Now let us consider this vector of case 3. So here ve bar equal to v1 bar minus c1 to v2 bar. So the c12 is the similarity component between the given two vectors. And this similarity, if the similarity is more, then the error between the vectors will be less. For example, let us consider a timeline. For example, I am telling you, this timeline is having the numbering 0, 5, then 10, then 15, then 20, then 25, then 30, let us consider. Let us consider this is related to a V2 vector. And we have also another timeline, which is related to the vector V1. So here it is 0, then 5, then 10, then 15, then 20. Now the similarity component between those two vectors, we can write as this portion. So this becomes the similarity component or component of V1 along V2, right? Now this particular portion is not covering, so we can call this one as error. So we can say it is error vector. Now here, what we have to understood that the similarity component, the similarity between the two vectors is maximum. The similarity between the two vectors is maximum, so that this error becomes zero. That is, the error becomes minimum. So in the same way, this component C12 is chosen such that the error becomes minimum. So error becoming minimum is zero. So zero equal to V1 bar minus C12 V2 bar. So here we can write V1 bar equal to C1 to V2 bar. So here the component of V1 can be written as V1 bar equal to C1 to V2 bar. So if C12 is maximum, then the error becomes zero. Here we can also say that if C12 equal to zero, if C12 equal to zero, then we can say the vector v1 and vector v2 are perpendicular to each other. If they are perpendicular to each other, we can say the vector v1 and vector v2 are independent to each other. That means there is no similarity component existed between the vectors v1 and v2. For our convenience, let us take the dot product between the two vectors A bar and B bar. So we can write A bar dot B bar equal to B bar dot A bar. And we can also write A bar dot B bar equal to AB cos theta. Now, from this particular expression, if we try to write the components of the vectors, so the component of vector A bar along B bar, which is equal to A bar dot B bar by B equal to A cos theta. So the component of vector A bar along B bar is nothing but A cos theta, which can be written as A bar dot B bar by B. The same way, the component of vector B bar along A bar can be written as A bar dot B bar by A equal to B cos theta. Similarly, for the considered vectors V1 bar and V2 bar, the component of vector V1 bar along V2 bar is given by V1 bar dot V2 bar by V2, right? And it is the component of the vector V1 along the V2. We can write that one as C1 to V2. So from this particular expression, we can write C1 to V2 equal to V1 bar dot V2 bar by V2, so that we can make C1 to equal to V1 bar dot V2 bar by V2 square. So this becomes the similarity component between the vectors V1 bar and V2 bar. And at the same time, we know the dot product between the vectors will be A bar dot A bar will be equal to A square. In the same way, if we write V2 bar dot V2 bar will be equal to V2 square. So here we can also write the similarity component between the vectors V1 bar dot V2 bar by V2 bar dot V2 bar. So this way also we can write the similarity component of the vectors V1 bar and V2 bar. Here, if V1 bar and V2 bar are perpendicular to each other, that means what? There is no similarity component between those two vectors, so that C12 becomes zero. So whenever we want to prove that the given two vectors are perpendicular to each other, and we are going to calculate the similarity component between those two vectors, and we try to make it zero, so that we can conclude that the given two vectors are perpendicular to each other. Now we can also extend this one to the signals. So as we know that what is a signal is. So we know the signal is a physical quantity which can carry some kind of information in it. So here we will be considering two signals. Let us consider the two signals as F1 of t and F2 of t. These two signals, we are going to approximate the signal F1 of t in terms of F2 of t over the interval T1 and T2. So here the T1 less than T2 is the taken interval. Now when we approximate the F1 of t in terms of the second signal, so here it is approximated to C1 to F2 of t. How we can write this? Already we know that from the signals, from the vectors, we can write V1 bar equal to C1 to V2 bar. So in the same sense, we have written here. Now, we also write the error vector, error signal, that is Fu of t, which will be equal to F1 of t minus C1 to F2 of t here. How we can write this expression, since we know that the error vector can be written as V1 bar minus C1 to V2 bar. So here what we are doing is this V1 is approximated as the signal F1 of t, and V2 is vector V2 is approximated as F2 of t, right? Now you just consider like this, and here to get the similarity component maximum, that is if the similarity component is maximum, this error vector will be zero. Now, in order to minimize this signal here in this case, what we have to do is we have a possibility that we can take the average of this error signal so that the error will be minimized. And we consider that average of this error signal over the interval T1 to T2. So in that sense, we can write the average of this particular signal. So the average over the interval T1, T2 can be written as 1 over T2 minus T1 integration T1 to T2. And it is f u of t dt. And already we know the expression for the f u of t as f1 of t minus c1 to f2 of t. We try to substitute that one. 1 over t2 minus t1 integration t1 to t2. Then it becomes f1 of t minus c1 to f2 of t dt here. Now, here we are going to get a problem that if you go for the simply average of this particular error signal, then we are going to get a spurious result. That is wrong result we are getting. How we can see that? For example, let us take a sinusoidal signal. If you integrate the sinusoidal signal over the period 0 to 2 pi sine t dt, which gives us 0. So here, what you have to understood is that when the integration is taken over the sine t, it gives the area under the curve. So this integral talks about the area under the curve, right? So here there is peak values of positive and negative, and they may cancel each other, telling the value as 0. But if you look at this part here, by looking at this particular sine wave, here it is plus and here it is minus. Now the area under the curve is combination of this positive half cycle and this negative half cycle. So when we look at this particular wave mathematically, then the positive half cycle and negative half cycle, they get cancelled and the value that we get 0. But actually it is the area under the curve, where the area under the curve is not 0, right? So this, in this way, we are going to get a wrong indication about the error signal. Now, what we are going to do is that to correct this, we choose to minimize the average of the square of the error by denoting the average of square of the error by epsilon. Now, we take the error as epsilon. Now, this epsilon will be minimized by taking the average of, that is 1 over T2 minus T1, average of integration T1 to T2, square of that error signal, right? That is FET. Now, we take the average of the square of the error signal so that we try to make the error as 0. Now what we are going to do is, we try to substitute the expression for f u of t, and here it becomes 1 over t2 minus t1, then t1 to t2. So here that f u of t signal is given as f1 of t minus c1 to f2 of t whole square, then dt. Now expanding this particular thing as a minus b whole square, then we can write epsilon equal to, that is the error. So 1 over T2 minus T1, then integration T1 to T2, then it will be F1 square of T minus 2 C1 to F1 of T, F2 of T plus C1 to square, F2 square of T dt. Now, in order to minimize this error, we have to differentiate this error with respect to the similarity component. That means if the similarity component is maximum, the error becomes 0. So that's why we are differentiating this error with respect to the similarity component. So here we can write d epsilon by dc12, and we try to make it 0. So once it is equated to 0, so that we can find out the maximum similarity component, that makes sure that the error became 0. Now, we are writing that particular expression as, therefore, d of dc12 of 1 over t2 minus t1, integration over t1 to t2, then f1 square of t minus 2 c1 to f1 of t, f2 of t plus c12 square, f2 square of t, then dt, making it equal to 0. Now we are rearranging the expression as well as taking the differentiation inside the expression. Then we get 1 over t2 minus t1 of integration t1 to t2. Now we are giving the integration to each and every term inside. So here integration t1 to t2 d over dc12 of f1 square of t then dt minus 2 integration t1 to t2 d over dc12 of c12 f1 of t f2 of t dt plus integration t1 to t2 d over dc12 of c12 square f2 square of t dt, which can be equated to 0, right? Now 1 over t2 minus t1, integrating this one. Here we will not find any c12 term, so this particular integration becomes 0. So here it is 0 minus 2, then we have one c12 term here, so this becomes 1, and we left over with integration t1 to t2 f1 of t then f2 of t dt plus, here we have c12 square and we are differentiating this term with respect to c12, then it becomes 2 c12 and integration t1 to t2 f2 square of t dt, which is equal to 0. Now we can write this entire expression as minus 2 integration t1 to t2 f1 of t f2 of t dt plus 2 c12 integration t1 to t2 f2 square of t dt equated to 0. Now we can write that particular expression as 2 c12 integration t1 to t2 f2 square of t dt is equal to 2 integration t1 to t2 then f1 of t f2 of t dt here. So here on the both sides we can see that there is a constant, that is 2. So here the similarity component c12 can be written as integration t1 to t2 f1 of t f2 of t dt over integration t1 to t2 f2 square of t dt. So this becomes the similarity component between the given two signals f1 of t and f2 of t. So here we can understand this one by comparing with the vectors. So the vectors in case of vectors c12 is given as v1 bar dot v2 bar by v2 square. So in the same way we can write this particular expression. Now we know that when v1 bar dot v2 bar equal to 0, now the vectors are orthogonal to each other. In the same way, here we can write the integration t1 to t2 f1 of t f2 of t dt equal to 0 indicates the f1 of t and f2 of t are mutually orthogonal. They are mutually orthogonal, right? Now we can come to a conclusion about the analogy between the vectors as well as the signals. As if we have the vector v1 dot v2, then it can be approximated in terms of signals as integration t1 to t2 then f1 of t f2 of t then dt. Now v2 bar dot v2 bar, which is equal to v2 square, in the same sense we can approximate the signals as integration t1 to t2 f2 square of t dt. Even if it is a v1 vector, so the dot product between v1 vector and itself, then we get v1 square, so that it can be approximated to integration t1 to t2 f l square of t dt. So in the same way we can write, and v1 bar dot v2 bar by v2 square can be approximated as t1 to t2 f1 of t f2 of t dt over integration t1 to t2 f2 square of t dt. So this way, if we know the relationship between the vectors, then we can easily establish the relation between the given signals. So this is the beauty of the analogy, that makes us the new things very simple by comparing with the known phenomena. Hope you understood the importance of analogy and how we can create the relationship between the signals by comparing the relationship between the vectors. So thanks for watching. Do subscribe my channel, and also you can give certain comments in the comment box so that I can make the videos more productive. Thank you.